the Holy Gospel according to the book of John, the 18th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I'm not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
Please be seated. I once heard or was told that every pastor pretty much has one sermon, and we say it in different ways, and we have one kind of favorite message, one basic foundational piece of who we are, and we just speak it in different ways. And I think mine is something like this: we need to get out of our own way so God can be God and Jesus can be King. We are so caught in our own humanity and our own stuff, our limitations that we don't always see as even limitations, that we aren't able to see what God has for us. We're limited by our language, by our knowledge, by our study, by our belief, by our plain old humanity, and that in all of our wisdom, God keeps talking and acting and being and poking at us so that we might learn more, grow more, and be more. And as I think about Christ the King Sunday, think about the kingdom that God has in store for us and the way that we might envision a kingdom here in this world. And they're nothing alike. Years ago, I had the opportunity to go to Israel and Palestine as part of a seminary group. And as we're driving through the center of the city, we were on a bus, and we were just watching people live their lives, going on about their daily business. And the young people are required to do at least a year of military service. And they are required to carry their weapons wherever they go. So there's girls, young ladies, carrying shopping bags in one hand with their big rifles across their back. Didn't seem comfortable to me, but that's their world. And as we were watching down one alleyway, I caught a couple of children messing around and kind of goofing around with one of these soldiers. There was laughter, there was play, and in my head, all I can think of is, that guy's got a really big gun on his back. And these kids are playing with him. They didn't think anything of it. It was what was their expected norm. A little bit later in that trip, we were in Jerusalem, and there was a group of soldiers that were coming to sightsee at one of the tombs or one of the holy places, and they couldn't bring their guns in. So in this little courtyard, there was a doorway, an alcove, and so they piled all of their guns there. Just probably 25, 30 rifles. Just there, kind of out of the way. And then there's a nun who needed to get to that door. And she just pulled her robe up and she stepped around and over and through all those weapons of destruction to get to her holy place. She wasn't surprised, she wasn't frustrated, she was just going about her life. Again, did not seem comfortable to me. And then I still struck with the thought, what does that kingdom of Christ look like? Because those children, those people in nations that have been exposed to and grown up with this as a norm, they feel comfortable with guns. I don't feel comfortable with guns. That's not what I have grown up to be. So is the kingdom of Christ empty of weapons because there's no need? Or is it full of weapons so that what's important can be protected? We can't just decide that heaven should look like ours, the ones that we are comfortable with. What about people that you might see closer to home? You might drive around the city or go shopping and go to work and see there's someone walking down the street, kind of probably homeless, you assume, nonchalantly looking a little bit lost in raggedy clothes. A lot of passerbys will move to the other side of the sidewalk, or they'll cross the street. The clothing worn is a little outdated, it's well worn. Things that you or I might designate for the comfortable clothes that we only wear at home, we don't go out in public in. But this man on the street, even though his clothes are the comfortable kind, doesn't look comfortable. But when he lives on the street, what's replaceable? It isn't possible to replace what you don't have. And so, especially this time of year, you just layer, regardless of how fashionable it is, you just layer on whatever you have. What this person owns fits in a plastic bag. Looks like a lot of stuff to carry, but it really isn't very much to own. If you've ever tried to help, you might find that the person that you think needs your help doesn't want it, doesn't need it. You might ask the man in tattered clothes if you can help. Can I get you anything? Do you need a few bucks, a cup of coffee? But the man in tattered clothes might not want anything. Doesn't want money for lunch. He doesn't really need anything. And so you, as that person trying to help, might walk away feeling rejected. Why doesn't he want what I can offer? I could give him what he needs. And yet, maybe that person doesn't need what you offer. What about the biases that we hold about people in tattered clothing or those who carry everything in the garbage bag with them? We sometimes feel like we're doing such a good thing, it should be our way, and yet that's not always what people need. We see scenarios like this playing out in our lives all the time. We pass people on the streets, in the aisles of grocery stores, in the parking lot, and we wonder if we should help or how we should help. And we walk away when people accept our help feeling better about ourselves. We don't think we're supposed to be rejected or shunned. But then we have to recognize that this is our blessed world. It's a world where we have clean clothing. We've learned, we've got our tattered ones that we keep for special occasions at home. We have enough to eat. We have a place to lay our heads at night. It's a world of support for us, financial support, support for our emotions, for our faith, for our life. A world where there's a promise of the future that we think rests only in education and employment, a world that is really unlike the street. And yet, the gentleman in the ragged clothes was just fine that day. He had what he needed, even though it might not have been what we think he needed. He spoke, he thought, he acted, he operated from a world that was so foreign to most of us, because thankfully that's not the world we live in. And that's what it seems to be in the gospel today. Pilate, a Roman, and Jesus come face to face and they try to talk. Pilate wants to know who this Jesus is, and that's why he asks, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Now we know, of course, the way that the story plays out. Jesus is soon going to be put to death by this man's command. Pilate lives in a world of politics and power. What he said went, and I think he suspected what he was up against, because he really wanted the Jews and the Jewish authorities to deal with this Jesus. But Pilate was the one that had to make the decision. Pilate was the one in whom everyone held fear at that time. And so things were accomplished, people were convinced and coerced, but just by their sense of unworthiness in the face of Pilate. And this is the man who questions Jesus. Are you the king? Are you going to claim some of my territory? Because Pilate doesn't want to share. Now we get to this peek inside the world of Jesus. His answer is simple and direct. My kingdom, it's not of this world. It's not what you can understand. It's otherworldly. It's beyond what you know. It's almost supernatural. Jesus' world has things that we can't begin to imagine. Jesus' world has the bread of life. Jesus' world has the water that keeps us from thirst forever. How do we know and live in the knowledge that there's something so much greater, so much stronger, and so much more powerful than anything else in our lives today? How do we get outside ourselves enough to recognize that God's world is so much better than ours? Jesus is more powerful in this story than Pilate because he doesn't want Pilate's power. The world that Jesus reigns is beyond us. It's out of our limited kind of self-absorbed lives in this world. But what do we know? We know that it's God's world, and we know that Jesus is King. We know it's marvelous, whatever that might be. It's a world where people are free from illness and from strife. The family squabbles and tensions in the world are no longer. People have enough food to eat and a place to lay their head at night. It's a place of love and wonder. It's a place of mystery and of comfort, even when that comfort is different to different people. It's a place where we might have our hearts cemented and our tears dried permanently, not just temporarily. It's a place where no one crosses the street when another walks by. It's a place where our most comfortable clothing, tatters and all, is worn proudly, and we don't need someone to help us or to fix us because there's nothing broken. It's a kingdom that we can only catch glimpses of from this vantage point. We know that Jesus is there, our Savior, our Redeemer, our King, because he tells us, "This is what I was born for. This is why I came into this world." Because everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice. There's another story I want to share with you about a young boy who understands God's kingdom better than we ourselves. It's a young boy who's got an infant sister who was diagnosed with a blood disease. His parents' blood doesn't match. He, the little boy, again, a 3-4-year-old boy is the best source of a blood donation. And so his parents explained to him that they would like to take his blood to make his sister better. He bravely agrees, and so the nurses start their work. They insert the needle that they do, and they attach the bag, and the bag slowly fills up. The boy's quiet and subdued. He gathers the energy, or maybe the guts, to talk. And he asks the nurse, How long will it be, and how much will it hurt? The parents and the nurses don't understand what he's getting at, because he's already gone through the worst of the poking and the prodding. He goes on in his little boy way to explain that he's giving his blood away, and he just wanted to know what it would be like to have none left. He wanted to know what it would be like to die. When he was asked to give up his blood, he thought he was to give every last drop to die so that his sister would live. And he was willing to do so. That young boy didn't argue ferociously. He didn't debate his life over his sister's. He didn't pick a side and offer all that he could against someone else's. He simply stood in the middle and agreed to offer what he had, his very life. And he was willing to do it. We need to reevaluate our definition of power and strength, of what's right and what's wrong, of what's good and what's bad. Because that little boy laying in that room attached to tubes, his blood collecting in a bag at his side, he's the one who had the power that overruled everyone else's in that room. He stood tall and strong in the middle of two sides, and his power was like Christ's, not from our human world. So on the day when we celebrate Christ the King, we see him on a throne, but not a throne that we would design. He's on a throne that's wooden and in the shape of a cross. It isn't created by power or might or coercion, but with that strong, vulnerable love that unites a splintered world. In God's world, in God's kingdom, people don't stand on different sides holding guns or not holding guns, feeding someone or not feeding someone, offering help or not offering help. They stand surrounding the cross, that crown of Jesus Christ the King. And in that space, they offer Jesus' power and love to one another. That's why we gather. Around the word, around the table, because it is up to us to try to look outside our own limitations to see who it is that this world offers to us in the sign of Jesus Christ, who stands as our King. We are signs ourselves of the glorious and gentleness of God when we choose to be that way. And we do it as we stand tall and humble in the presence of this King, and we just love however it is that someone else needs to be loved, just as Jesus did. We don't know what that world is going to look like, but we know it's beyond our wildest imagination. I can't wait to be there someday.